Welcome to this day of Pentecost Sunday. And a warm welcome is extended to any visitors worshiping with us today and to our viewers on Eastlink Community TV and on YouTube and to those listening on CFTA Community Radio. We welcome and thank Tyler Buchanan, who will be participating in today's music as our organist. And I draw your attention to the announcements found in today's church bulletin. Particularly, in support of World Central Kitchen, the congregation is invited to make donations by June the 30th, 2024. Trinity St. Stephen's will match your donation up to $5,000. Donations may be left with Erica in the church office. The office will be closed on Monday. Groups meeting this week are UCW Unit 2 and Open Circle Drop-In. Please see your bulletin for the time and location of your meeting. Also, the congregation is invited to share in coffee and conversation in Burgess Hall following today's service. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Reverend Susan Gamblin, and I welcome each one of you to this service today. And I'm so pleased that so many of you have arrived wearing red. As we remember what it means to live in gratitude, let us give thanks to the indigenous peoples of this land. And let us remember we worship God in Mi'kma'ki, the historic and unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq. As Christ's people, let us be people of love, truth, and reconciliation.
Thank you.
have come to celebrate the birthday of the church. We've come to celebrate Pentecost and to open ourselves to God's Spirit that it might fill us. Spirit of the living God, visit us once again. Come, Holy Spirit, come. On rushing winds that sweep away all barriers, come, Holy Spirit, come. With tongues of fire that sets our hearts aflame, come, Holy Spirit, come. With love that eliminates the boundaries of clan and nation, come, Holy Spirit, come. In the name of God, the Holy One, and of Jesus Christ, our Savior, come, Holy Spirit, come. And together we pray. O God, you have poured love into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. Help us to direct our thoughts and prayers to you in praise, that your power might fill this church and our lives as it filled your people throughout the ages. Teach us to be your church and your people as we together pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Do not let us fall into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Please be seated. Okay. I would like at this time for you to join me in our responsive prayer of confession. Spirit of God, you are the breath of creation, the wind of change that blows through our lives, opening us up to new dreams and new hopes, new life in Jesus Christ. Forgive us our closed minds, which barricade themselves against new ideas, preferring the past to what you might want to do through us tomorrow. Forgive our closed eyes, which fail to see the needs of your world, blind to opportunities of service and love. Forgive our closed hands, which clutch our gifts and our wealth for our own use alone. Forgive us our closed hearts, which limit our affections to ourselves and our own. Spirit of new life, forgive us and break down the prison walls of our selfishness, that we might be open to your love and open for the service of your world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God's unfailing love sustains and upholds us. Where the Spirit is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit is, there is safety. Where the Spirit is, there is love. Receive God's forgiveness. Come alive in Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Thank you. Christ is with us. In Christ we are a new creation. Thanks be to God. Let us offer one another signs of reconciliation and love. And you're allowed to dance on Pentecost, you know. Peace of Christ to all of you. Peace of Christ. Reading from the book of Acts, the coming of the Holy Spirit. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every people under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one had heard them speaking in the native tongue of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Fellow Jews and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall discern dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Herein is wisdom. Thanks be to God for the word. Please be seated. A reading from the Gospel of John. When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify, because you have been with me from the beginning. I have said these things to you to keep you from stumbling. They will put you out of the synagogues. Indeed, an hour is coming when those who kill you will think that by doing so, they are offering worship to God. And they will do this because they have not known the Father or me. But I have said these things to you so that when their hour comes, you may remember that I told you about them. I did not say these things to you from the beginning, because I was with you. But now I'm going to him who sent me. Yet none of you asks me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the advocate will not come to you, but if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. This is the good news of Jesus Christ. Let's bow our heads. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts together be pleasing to you, God, our Creator, our Redeemer, our Sustainer. Peter and the others always stopped listening at "be killed" and missed hearing "on the third day rise." Distracted by their inner pain, they stopped listening too soon and missed the good news and the bad, the joy and the sorrow. None of them has stopped to reflect that he's going to God and sending a gift back from God. None of them has paused to hear that it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send it to you. Despite his promises of the sending of the Spirit, the risen Lord does not find his disciples confidently waiting for him to come and breathe on them and give them the gift of the Holy Spirit. They aren't behaving like a group of people who've been promised the Holy Spirit. Why is that? Perhaps they had selective hearing, and sometimes we do too. We perpetuate their habit whenever we focus so intently on the painful aspects of the condition of our current lives, we forget we've been promised the Spirit and don't factor in what this power and presence in our lives can accomplish, not only for ourselves, but for others. The Spirit may challenge and rebuke. After all, the Spirit is God. But its intention is always the creation of wise, compassionate, and healthy people and communities. The inspiration of the Holy Spirit is not occasional, nor is it parochial, but all-encompassing, inviting forth all life with visions appropriate to the current complexity and context of our living. To be liberated from their sorrow, the disciples need to discover a joy that is just as startling as their pain. This joy, like life, is anticipated as a gift, arriving at the most unexpected moments. It unveils the hope that so often remains hidden, the hope from which we draw the spirit of compassion and generosity to live for others. It's easy to feel bent over with responsibilities and burdened with sadness about things going on in our lives and the lives of family members and friends. It's easy to be pulled down with the weight of all the things that are going wrong in the world. And it's especially challenging to stand straight when people on opposite sides of the political spectrum see the world and its peoples and the sharing of the resources so differently. Have you ever experienced a situation of pain and sorrow that was transformed into joy? In your daily life, what helps you to opt for joy? How does this option change the way you see your life and the events in it? Could there be a particularly troubling situation you face right now that might be transformed in unexpected ways if you kept listening to Jesus until he finishes his sentence, "I must go away"? The good news is Jesus is our sympathetic, empathetic high priest, identifying with us, empathizing and sympathizing with us. And as we turn to him, we receive grace, mercy, and help in our weakness, suffering, and sinfulness. In the midst of suffering, is this your image of God? In your suffering, do you see God as your advocate, as your protector, and as your ally? When suffering friends or acquaintances come to us, do they experience us as their caring advocate, as their concerned protector, as their empathetic ally? In her article, Compassion and Restorative Action, Cori Esperanza argues that empathetic understanding is one of the components of compassion. She shares a definition of compassion as being moved at one's gut level depths by the pain or bliss of another, and responding in ways that intend to ease their suffering or promote their flourishing. Compassion then involves something we experience inside of ourselves, which includes empathy, as well as the actions we take in response to what we experience. Everyone has a degree of compassion within them, whether small or great, that defines their character and their actions. The spiritual gift of compassion and mercy is a special gift whereby the Spirit enables certain Christians to feel exceptional empathy and compassion for those who are suffering in any way. Christians with this gift of the Spirit cannot help but focus upon alleviating the sources of pain or discomfort in those facing hardship and crisis. They often voluntarily serve in difficult or dangerous circumstances, and they do so with joy. Volunteers with World Central Kitchens, Doctors Without Borders are just two examples of those compelled to do something for the other, no matter the cost. Two communication scholars, Kathleen Verberber and Rudolf Verberber, describe empathy as a cognitive process, something we can learn, something we can decide to engage in or not engage. They suggest specific actions as a pathway to nurture empathy. This is what they say. Make an effort to understand your conversation partners. Treat your conversation partners as persons with value, not as objects. Pay serious attention to what they are saying. Pay serious attention to what they feel about what they are saying. And be observant and try to read people's nonverbal behavior. So what is the difference between love and empathy? Love requires empathy and compassion, tolerance, flexibility, compromise, and a whole host of other qualities and characteristics. In becoming human, Jesus entered into empathy with us. He experienced all the emotion we experience as humans. And in knowing the pain of others, he was led to perform great miracles. He addressed the needs of the lonely and forgotten and rejected. He felt for the plight of the blind, the lame, and all sinners. And he was concerned with individual or social issues that oppress. Jesus offers a new alternative to rely on the Spirit's presence in the adversities of life. The Holy Spirit is not coming, but is here. The Holy Spirit, the advocate, the presence of the risen Jesus in his physical absence is with us. The Spirit has already freed us from the law of sin and of death. It searches the depths of our hearts, prays in us when we cannot find the words, and pours the love of God into our hearts, giving us hope. So when confronted with negativity, doubts, sacrifices, and bad news, we don't have to assume that the Spirit is absent. We don't have to act without it. And we don't even really have to invoke the Spirit. We have the promise. We can own the truth. The Spirit now lives in us, and we now live in the Spirit. If you're suffering today, you are not alone. Jesus is standing with you, empathizing with you. He has felt the pain you feel and is connected with you in it. And if you are suffering from ongoing trauma or abuse, you can trust Jesus to guide you to those who will find you a place of safety. As you share his suffering, no matter what that looks like, Jesus extends a gift to sustain you, the power of the Holy Spirit. What does it mean that the Spirit will guide you into all truth? Truth is where we dwell as believers, such that within that truth, the Spirit can situate us in the larger truth of Christ. The truth incarnate, present in the world, is instantly, inevitably entangled with the conditions and aspirations, as well as our human fantasy and deceit. Jesus had instructed his disciples to stay in Jerusalem until they had been clothed with power from on high. This adventurous spirit is surely at work among them. They are surprised by wind, flame, and word. The ecstatic experience of Jesus' first followers drives them from the shadows of fear into the streets, sharing words of graceful transformation with people of all nations. We see the animating energy and effervescence that exists at the center of the universe. They had obeyed and stayed, and it was in Jerusalem. There, they were overwhelmed by the Spirit in the forms of tongues of fire, of multiple and comprehensible languages. There's something wonderful about a shared love and a shared enthusiasm, one person for the other, that is so intense it results in a never-ending dance of affirmation and celebration. In this eternal dance, the Spirit seeks no glory, but instead offers the ongoing revelation of the joy of the resurrection on behalf of the Son. And the good news, we are the benefactors who the Spirit helps witness to Jesus as we glorify him in promoting the welfare of another. Pentecost joins mysticism with mission. As the church born at Pentecost, we go beyond homogeneity to embrace diversity in all its many forms. That's what it means to be church for Pentecost, to be a unity in diversity, moving outward in ever-expanding circles of grace. Divine omnipresence is an all or nothing doctrine. There is no such thing as being a little omnipresent. God is an active, personal, intimate, and vision-oriented presence, moving always and everywhere in the direction of shalom. God's Spirit touches every life, aiming us toward communion, inspiration, and creation. Pentecost is not really an event we wait for. It's one in which we participate, because every moment is Pentecost. Today, Pentecost Sunday celebrates the many and varied expressions of God's love and wisdom. The divine dancer moves through all creation, bringing forth life and love and inspiration. Fire and wind are everywhere. Inspiration and revelation are just a moment away and can come either by surprise or a result of the interplay of God's wisdom and our intentional spiritual practices. The Spirit blows where it wills, in all directions, and embracing all peoples. We listen to the Spirit as did those first Pentecost people and prepare to move with the Spirit. And that means mission. When we operate from a place of mission, new and more exciting missions emerge, bringing wholeness to us and to those we serve. Practicing Pentecost involves having an eye for diversity, to be open to the many reflections of God in the world and in humankind. If we think God is omnipresent and then every moment can bring inspiration and invitation, everyone deep down is hearing God and can be a companion on the Pentecost journey, despite and especially as a result of their differences. We are one and many in God's ever-surprising Spirit. Let us breathe in God's Spirit, making every moment a prayer and a mission. Amen. Please be seated. As Christ's Pentecost people, we offer our physical and spiritual gifts for the loving transformation of this world. May we join with others in ministry to live Christ's love in order to refresh, refill, and renew the world God has created and is creating. Please join me in our prayer of thanksgiving. In the name and in the Spirit of Jesus, we bring our gifts to you, O God. With them we offer a ready mind, a willing spirit, and a joyful heart. With them we offer our various ministries, that each of us may be part of your answers to the cries of the world. Accept and use these our gifts, we pray, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be seated. As we come into our time of prayers of the people, I want to mention first that last Sunday, Helen Smith passed away, and after the service, we didn't know that at the time, and her funeral has already taken place on Wednesday. And it was lovely, and the food that UCW provided was lovely too. And I thank you for that. Couldn't have been a more beautiful day for us to lay Helen to rest also. So, and then I want to speak about a joy, a real joy. And so would you move to the next slide? I don't know if you knew this was coming or not. But our region has new processes. And Ruth Gamble has been a designated lay minister in Chignecto Presbytery forever, I don't know how long, for a long, long time, as a DLM. She has gone through interviews, and she and six other DLMs were ordained at our regional meeting last week. This is true empathy. I'm so happy for her. I have some other photos of her that I will be posting this week, but this was taken by somebody who was kind enough to forward it to me. It was a very special day for her, as you can imagine, and well deserved. Yes, and she's working this week, or I'd have had her come here. But anyway, that's a really joyous occasion for her and for the church. And I will tell you, when I was ordained, that after the laying on the hands ceremony, I was a new person. So I'm sure she is too. Okay, so that's really exciting. So let's go to God in prayer. Gracious God, we pray for the faithful all over the world, that they may be united in your service. Oh God, as we go to our homes this week and our work, we ask you to send the Holy Spirit into our lives. Open our ears that we may hear what you're saying to us in the things that happen to us, and in the people we meet and what happens to them. Open our eyes that we may see the needs of people around us, the needs of people who are not voicing their needs to us. Open our hands that we may do our work well and help wherever help is needed. Open our lips that we may tell the good news of Jesus and bring comfort, happiness, and laughter to others. Open our minds that we may discover new truth about you and the world. Open our hearts that we may love you and others as you have loved us. Amen.
Thank you.
out into God's world filled with the spark of the Holy Spirit. Let love guide your actions. Listen for the Spirit of Truth. Spread the peace of Christ and remind everyone you meet that each one is a beloved child of God. Amen.